Good afternoon and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you are in the know. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Joe Epstein, past chair of the club's Board of Governors, and your chair for today's program. And now it is my pleasure to introduce today's distinguished speaker, Robert Mnookin, professor and chair of the negotiation program at Harvard Law School and author of the new book, Bargaining with the Devil, When to Negotiate and When to Fight. It was over 15 years ago, while jogging with Bob Mnookin on a Northern California trail, that I first learned about his work with major cases of dispute resolution. And it was on that day that Bob was giving me an overview of his participation as a neutral party in a landmark dispute over operating system software between IBM and Fujitsu. More recently, Bob was called on to participate in a dispute resolution between two sovereign cultures in Belgium, the Flemish and the Walloon peoples. And then, the seemingly never-ending conflict between Palestinians and Israelis demanded his efforts. This conflict is especially difficult, according to Mnookin, because it involves two parties who feel a sense of historic victimization. Contrast his participation in those issues with his service on the appellate panel that reviewed the salary cap dispute between the National Basketball Association and its players' union, and you can get a good sense of the broad scope of knowledge and talents that he possesses. So what kind of person stands out to massive global corporations and to ancient cultures that have seemingly unsolvable conflicts and disputes? Such a person, of course, is Robert Mnookin, our guest today. Bob is the Samuel Williston Professor of Law at Harvard Law School, the chair of the Steering Committee of Harvard Law's Program on Negotiation, and the director of the Harvard Negotiation Research Project. Professor Mnookin has applied his interdisciplinary approach to a wide range of both public and private problems. He's written or edited 9 books and numerous scholarly articles, and this includes Beyond Winning, Negotiating to Create Value in Deals and Disputes, which won the CPR Institute of Dispute Resolution Book Prize for the year 2000, and Negotiating on Behalf of Others. Before joining the Harvard faculty, Professor Mnookin was the Adelbert H. Sweet Professor of Law at Stanford Law School. Bob received his A.B. in economics from Harvard College in 1964, and his law degree also from Harvard in 68. He was a law clerk for Supreme Court Justice John M. Harlan, and he then joined the San Francisco law firm of Howard Rice Nemirovsky, Kennedy, Robertson, and Falk. He began teaching at UC Berkeley's Bolt Hall in 72 and was on the Stanford faculty from 1981 to 1993. He's been a visiting fellow at Wolfson College at Oxford University, a visiting professor of law at Columbia Law School, holder of the International Franke Chair in Belgium, and a fellow at the Center for Advanced Study in the Behavioral Sciences at Stanford. Since President Obama campaigned on a platform that promised that he would negotiate with our enemies, including the Taliban, a striking contrast, of course, to President George W. Bush, who was a strong foe of not appeasing, and negotiating with our adversaries, the publication of Professor Mnookin's latest book, Bargaining with the Devil, is a timely and a meaningful work of scholarship. So we are pleased to welcome to the Commonwealth Club's podium Professor Robert Mnookin.
To be sitting up here with two dear friends, Joey Epstein and Connie Shapiro, and seeing so many friends and loved ones from our life in the Bay Area here at the Commonwealth Club is simply thrilling. Thank you for being here. Should I bargain with the devil? By bargain, I mean try to make a deal. Try to resolve the conflict through negotiation rather than fighting it out. By devil, I mean an enemy or adversary who's intentionally harmed you in the past or you fear may harm you in the future. Someone you don't trust. An adversary whose behavior you may even see as evil. This book is about those most challenging kinds of conflicts. Now, in our news, every day, we read how our national leaders wrestle with these problems. What should the United States policy be towards negotiating with the Taliban? How about North Korea? With Iran? Issues come up with terrorists as well. But I'm also interested in this topic because it's my feeling that in private disputes, in business conflicts, and in even within one's own family, you may face devils of your own. I made a claim in a seminar I taught at the law school this fall that in nearly every family, if you go back a generation or two and include some cousins, and you ask, has there been a family conflict over family property about which people stopped speaking to each other? Now, the fight could be over a grandma's engagement ring. It could be over a business. In the book, I talk about one where it was a fight over a vacation home. But I'd be curious, if there were a raise of hands, how many would acknowledge that within their family, there has been a conflict of that sort? It looks like at least 40%, and that's consistent with my own experience, and I raised my hand as well. Now, you hear categorical answers to the question, should you bargain with the devil? In my field, the common response, of course, is that you should always be willing to negotiate. The core argument is appealing. Before war or litigation, try to work it out. See if you can't discover a resolution that better serves your own interests, and perhaps that of the other side as well, than litigation, much less warfare. Sitting down to negotiate doesn't mean that you have to give up what's important to yourself. It just means you've got to be prepared to try to solve the problem. People and regimes are capable of change. You can't hope to make peace with your enemies unless you're willing to negotiate. That's one side. And frankly, it's an appealing argument. But you've also heard probably the other side, the other categorical response. It's really based on the Faustian parable. It suggests you should never negotiate with the devil. The devil is clever and unscrupulous. The devil may tempt you by promising you something you really want, but it's likely the devil will just trick you. Most importantly, if you negotiate with the devil, you're going to violate your own integrity and pollute your soul. It wasn't so long ago that Vice President Dick Cheney declared after 9/11, quote, I've been charged by the president with making sure that none of the tyrannies of the world are negotiated with. We don't negotiate with evil, we defeat it. I reject both categorical claims. In fact, when I asked myself who my two greatest political heroes were of the 20th century, you might ask yourself that question. I came up with the following answer. My two greatest political heroes are Winston Churchill and Nelson Mandela. I have a chapter of the book about each of them. Churchill, in May of 1940, had just become prime minister. The phony war had ended, and Hitler's armies had moved west, and the Netherlands had fallen, Denmark had fallen, Belgium had capitulated, France was teetering and soon would fall. There were 150,000 British troops trapped on the coast. This was before Dunkirk. At the time, the United States was not in the war, and indeed Churchill was desperately writing Roosevelt asking for aid. The ambassador, by the way, to Great Britain at the time, was Joseph Kennedy, whose recommendation was that the British send their fleet to Canada, so after Great Britain was overrun, at least they could carry on from the Commonwealth. The Soviet Union, by the way, at this time, had signed the Hitler-Stalin Pact and was helping carve up Poland. They were not involved in the war. At this moment, the war cabinet of Churchill, which included Neville Chamberlain and Lord Halifax, debated for 4 days whether to accept what looked like an invitation from Mussolini to mediate between Great Britain and Germany to make peace. After the war, in Churchill's monumental five-volume history, he doesn't mention the fact that negotiation was ever considered. But in fact, the minutes of those meetings are now available, and I studied them. And it turns out it was an extraordinary debate. And in fact, it turned out to be a very difficult decision, where Churchill, along the way, made a lot of nonsensical arguments, but in the end, I think, made a wise decision based on a pretty sound argument. Mandela, but in all events, Churchill is my hero because he refused to negotiate. How about Mandela? Mandela's my hero because he chose to negotiate. After spending more than 20 years in prison in the mid-80s, having been convicted of treason, he'd been the head, by the way, of the guerrilla wing of the ANC, Mandela decided on his own that he would initiate discussions with the hated National Party, which had erected the apartheid regime. At the time, although most of us don't realize it, Mandela was not the head of the ANC. Oliver Tambo was the head of the ANC. But Oliver Tambo was in exile. Mandela was able to communicate with him, though, but it sometimes took weeks sneaking information in and out. However, right in the prison, Mandela had colleagues who were also ANC members. And the ANC prided itself on being run as a collective. In his wonderful memoir, Mandela asks, "I had to think about whether I should talk to my colleagues about the step I was about to take, because it was against the stated policy of the ANC. And he said, I thought about it and decided I would consult with no one. Why? Because he knew the answer they'd give, and they'd tell him not to do so. But he reached out and began a process, which of course ended up having a very happy result. If there's no easy categorical answer how in particular circumstances you should decide, the challenge is to make wise decisions in a particular context. My book tries to address that challenge. And I do so by considering 8 concrete cases in very different contexts, where an individual or disputant had to decide whether to negotiate or resist. I'm going to briefly describe one of the cases. All these cases are real cases, although for a couple of them, I changed names to protect confidentiality. Imagine that you're the founder of a small, privately owned research and development company in Silicon Valley. You're venture financed, and all you do is R&D to develop products. You develop a medical device, which you've licensed to a large Japanese company, the Bikuda Corporation. You give the Bikuda Corporation the right to manufacture and distribute this item, not in the United States and not in China, but in much of the rest of the world, for a royalty. Things go fine for a while. China, however, was excluded from the license agreement. And you discover to your horror that, in fact, the Bikuda Corporation was selling a knockoff of your product, slightly different, but only very slightly different, in China. When you confronted Bikuda, saying that they weren't allowed to do so under the license agreement, the response was, you really don't understand the Chinese market. Your royalty rates are much too high. Let's negotiate. Perhaps if you're willing to reduce the royalty rate, we'll include China, but you've got to reduce it worldwide. Now, in such circumstances, imagine the emotions you might feel. You'd be furious. This was your partner. You feel betrayed. You also probably are angry with yourself for having trusted them, for having done business with them. And in fact, it's likely that you need advice from a sage person. And in the book, I suggest this guy might be prepared to help you think through whether to negotiate or whether to fight. Mr. Spock is emotionally very detached. He's in complete control of his emotions, and he's the consummate rational analytic guy. Many of us would consider him a little bit of a cold fish, but he can step back and analyze situations without falling into a variety of traps. Now, the traps, and I want to talk about these traps, are a variety of responses, often knee-jerk responses, that make you want to fight when often you shouldn't. Demonization is at the top. You view your adversary as evil. Tribalism, our team versus their team. A dehumanization. In the worst kinds of conflicts, you're not even willing to acknowledge that the other side is human. Moralism is very common in these heated disputes. All right is on our side. We're completely right. They're completely wrong. As a negotiation teacher, the zero-sum fallacy is quite common. The zero-sum fallacy is the notion that what you win, I lose. What I win, you lose. It's only a distributive bargain. There's no possibility to expand the pie. You all know about the fight-flight trap. And, of course, the call to battle involves often a leader. It could be the leader of the company. It could be the leader of the clan. It could be the national leader calling you to battle. Now, the advantage is that if you have Mr. Spock, he's going to suggest to you to put aside and avoid these traps and ask yourself a set of questions. You've got to be a clear thinker. Most fundamentally, you've got to ask, what are your long-term interests? What are the other side's interests? What are your alternatives away from the table? What are the other side's alternatives if you don't negotiate? Are there potential negotiated outcomes that might better serve your interests than fighting it out? Now, Spock is a clear thinker and a brilliant strategist. And in the case I described, what Spock suggests to you is, although the possibility of litigating either in China or Japan is non-existent, and even though in the United States it would be difficult and uncertain whether you could get jurisdiction over the Baikuda Corporation, he recognized that, in fact, the Baikuda Corporation was interested in its reputation in terms of being able to negotiate other joint ventures. And the one thing you could do by being prepared to bring suit if necessary is that if you offered to negotiate but said, if it doesn't work, we're going to sue you, and we're going to sue you in California, and we recognize we may or may not be able to get jurisdiction, but whether we do or not, people are going to understand what you've done in the past. Anyway, Spock suggested this would be a way, this combination strategy, of getting their attention and negotiating. Now, there is a sixth question, and that is a question that really goes to questions of legitimacy, morality, identity, and self-respect. And part of the problem that I address in this book is the following. Spock is a utilitarian consequentialist. What Spock does is he wants to look ahead and try to assess the consequences of different courses of action. How about issues of identity? How about issues of principle? Issues of right, of justice? You can imagine an executive faced with this choice of whether to try this rather sophisticated strategy where you threaten to litigate, but you really prepare, you signal that you're prepared to negotiate, and you're willing to sit down and try to negotiate it out. You can imagine someone saying, I understand the argument now. And you're right. If I simply consider costs and benefits as you look at them, it may make sense to negotiate. But how about my reputation with myself? How about my belief that there should be justice and that the Baikuda Corporation should not profit from its own wrong? Often, when you bargain with the devil, you're going to give up the pursuit of justice in the face of pursuing interests that are important to you in terms of the future. This is not easy. Now, what I'd like to do is just say a few words about some of the other chapters to just give you a little bit of a taste. One of the chapters involves Rudolf Kastner, who bargained in 1944 with Adolf Eichmann. Kastner was a Hungarian Jew, a Zionist, who in fact thought that the Nazis could be negotiated with in the sense that they could be bribed. And indeed, through his negotiations with Eichmann, for a variety of reasons that I describe in the chapter, he was able to save 1,700 people that were put on a train that ultimately reached the safety of Switzerland. It's an extraordinarily tragic tale, because after the war, Kastner went to Israel. He was accused in the early 50s of collaboration. The accuser was sued for libel, and the trial judge condemned Kastner, saying that he had sold his soul to the devil by negotiating with Eichmann. That what Eichmann had bought was his silence, that he really knew what the fate of Hungarian Jewry was, that in order to save his family and select Hungarian Jews, he essentially, the judge thought, was responsible for hundreds of thousands of deaths. Over 500,000 Hungarian Jews died during 1944. The Israeli Supreme Court ultimately reversed that decision, but in the interim, Kastner was assassinated by a right-wing Israeli zealot. Not a happy tale. Another chapter deals with this man, Natan Sharansky. Sharansky refused to bargain. He was arrested by the KGB for being a refusenik. He, in fact, was served over 11 or 12 years in jail. He refused to have anything to do with the KGB, to negotiate with them at all. Ultimately, he was liberated because the United States exchanged a Soviet spy for Sharansky's freedom. Sharansky didn't know what was happening, but he was flown to East Berlin. And as he was leaving the plane, the KGB person that was with him said, there's a car waiting. Walk in a straight line from the airplane to the car. If you don't walk in a straight line, I assure you bad things are going to happen to you. Sharansky said to this guy, for 12 years, I've refused to make any deals with you. Why do you think I'm going to start now? And he walked in a crooked line to the car. Several of the chapters of the book involve disputes where I was involved one way or another. One was a huge battle between IBM at the time, the largest computer company in the world, and Fujitsu, who at the time was the second largest computer company in the world. IBM thought that Fujitsu had stolen its operating system software. There was plenty of demonization to go around, and it was an extraordinarily interesting experience I had as a neutral in that case, which I describe. I also, in fact, had the good fortune to be asked to work with the San Francisco Symphony, the musicians, the trustees, and the management. And I'm thrilled that here today are some friends from the San Francisco Symphony. It was a process of de-demonization. In fact, there weren't devils involved, but there were profound misunderstandings. And you may recall that the San Francisco Symphony had had a catastrophic strike, which in fact had had all kinds of adverse consequences. I was, for that reason, invited in by the musicians, the management, and the trustees to, in the words of someone from the Hewlett Foundation, teach these folks how to negotiate. It was successful in that there was a new contract negotiated early that was a long contract. And I'm happy to report there have been no strikes in the San Francisco Symphony since. On the other hand, I also have to acknowledge that in looking back and writing the chapter and finding out what had happened since, there's still plenty of hard bargaining going on, but I like to think that at least it's somewhat more civilized than it was in the past. There's a case about divorce, and there was a sibling battle over family property. There were two family cases as well. So I guess the question is, having posed to you the question, should you bargain with the devil? I've been told that for my elevator speech, I should be able to encapsulate an answer that's very short and succinct. My wife is skeptical that I have that capacity, but I can. Should you bargain with the devil? My answer is, not always, but more often than you feel like it. More often than you feel like it for two different sorts of reasons. One reason you're going to often not feel like it when you should is because of these various traps, emotional, psychological, political, that we are only too prone to fall into. The other reason more often than you feel like it is because it often does involve sacrificing to some degree principle on the altar of pragmatism, where you have to decide, looking forward, making peace, having some kind of reconciliation going forward, is worth the cost in terms of achieving justice for what may have happened in the past. Thank you very much.
Is it on now? Our thanks to Robert Mnookin, professor and chair of the negotiation program at Harvard Law School, and author of the new book, Bargaining with the Devil, When to Negotiate, When to Fight. I'm Connie Shapiro, past chair of the Commonwealth Club's Board of Governors, and I will be moderating today's audience question period. There are a number of questions, so I will begin immediately. Are there positive traps? In your presentation, you suggested there are a number of negative traps that inhibit negotiation when wisdom would suggest a despondent should negotiate. Disputant should negotiate.
That's a great question. In fact, in the book, although the emphasis is on the negative traps, because when it comes to bargaining with the devil, those traps are what's common. But in fact, I think I may even have a overhead that will help people follow it, but I'll read it. For each of these negative traps, in the book I describe an opposite kind of trap, tribalism, we they. The opposite trap is what I call naive universalism. Underneath, people are all the same. Suddenly, history, identity counts for nothing, people's experience. Demonization, the opposite trap, is what I call contextual rationalization. And that is, you can explain away almost any behavior by saying, oh, you've got to understand their perspective and the circumstances they were under. Moralism, the notion that one side's entirely at fault. We mediators typically have a mindset where we think everybody's at fault. Well, that's not always true. I mean, if you look at Hungary in 1944, everyone wasn't at fault. The zero-sum fallacy, the opposite fallacy, is the notion of win-win, that it's always going to be possible to expand the pie. So it's a great question, and in fact, although I think they are much less common, I think there are a set of ideological traps, a mindset, that can also get in the way of thinking clearly.
Okay, thank you. Should our government support efforts today to negotiate with the Taliban in order to bring about peace and reconciliation in Afghanistan?
I think the Taliban are not a unitary, undifferentiated, top-down organization, and I think you have to make very important distinctions. Let me offer three different kinds of Taliban. There are what I call the $10 Taliban. Now, the $10 Taliban are those who are fighting as part of the insurgency because they're being paid 10 bucks a day. And they have no ideological commitment. My view is we should offer them $11 and see if they could switch sides. That's one group. A second group that's somewhat more important are regional leaders who, in fact, have affiliated with the Taliban, but aren't ideologically or religiously deeply committed to the most extreme form of view of Islam. They may be primarily concerned with issues relating to the corruption of the national government and the failure of that government to be able to provide security. I think we should be negotiating with these regional leaders and seeing, in fact, if they could be willing to participate in state building of some sort. The third group, though, really involves Mullah Omar and his lieutenants, who now are primarily in Pakistan. It's easy to imagine a deal, although Mullah Omar presently, Karzai is asking him to negotiate and they've refused. But it's easy to imagine a deal because, I mean, I think what they are deeply committed to is trying to regain power in order to ideologically impose a certain vision of what they think Afghanistan should be like. I think any potential deal with the leadership on top would involve ceding to them, being involved in some kind of power-sharing arrangement where they could control a region and where I think they would hope to ultimately control the whole nation. And I think that would be very bad news indeed for women and girls, because I think they'd shut down women's schools. I think it would be very bad indeed for any cosmopolitans in Afghanistan. So my own view is, with respect to that third group, we should simply continue to resist. And my sense is that, in fact, the administration, in terms of these categories, has it about right.
So, should we negotiate with Iran? Why? When wouldn't we want to negotiate with Iran?
I think we should try to engage Iran. I am not optimistic at all about our ability to persuade Iran from securing, proceeding to get nuclear weapons, nor do I think we really are very likely to have the capacity to stop them. I say that sadly because I think the United States has a vital interest at stake. I think if Iran gets nuclear weapons, it's very likely that the Saudis and the Egyptians also will want it. And a Middle East region where there are now four powers with nuclear weapons is, in my mind, terribly frightening. Moreover, I think if Iran gets nuclear weapons, the non-proliferation regime, which has only been partially successful, but it has been partially successful in restraining proliferation, is likely to expire. That's very bad, I mean, for our children and our grandchildren, because you could imagine a world where there are 50 members of the nuclear club in 15 or 20 years, not half a dozen. On the other hand, the problem is we have no, in my view, good military option. We're between Iraq and Afghanistan, we've got our hands full. Moreover, I think the idea of through surgical attacks taking out their sites is very unlikely. A lot of them are hardened. At most, what it would probably do is set them back a couple years. It would likely be very destabilizing in terms of the Middle East. So I think that in fact, the Iranian regime perpetuates evil acts every day. In fact, dissidents probably, as we speak, are being executed in Iran. We can all hope that maybe the democratic groups are going to, at some point, be able to topple this regime, but I think it's far from certain they will. But in the meantime, I think we should try to engage them, and we should also try to use coercive economic sanctions. The dilemma there, as you all know, is that to make sanctions really work is going to require the cooperation of Russia and China. Russia may go along. The Chinese have been very resistant. So it's a problem from hell.
Does negotiating with terrorist organizations and countries like North Korea make us look weak, or will it actually make us safer?
Well, I think, in fact, being prepared to negotiate does not signal weakness. If you have in mind what your underlying interests are, and if you're prepared to be firm about those interests. I mean, the remarkable thing about the Mandela story is Mandela, from the outset, insisted on something that at the outset seemed entirely implausible, and that is one man, one vote. Not a consociational democracy where there'd be white vetoes. And he stuck to that. And of course, the National Party and the government that entered into negotiations with him, they never thought they'd get to that point, but they did ultimately. And he was patient and persistent. And in fact, there was always the implicit threat that South Africa would become ungovernable. So I think there's every reason to try. It's not going to always work.
Would Churchill and Mandela still be your heroes if the outcomes had gone the other way?
Well, that's a great question. It's one I struggle with and talk about in the book, because it's very easy after the fact to say, of course, the right decision was made. And that's why for each of these chapters, what I try to do is not simply ex post after the fact, say, hallelujah, obviously it was a wise decision because there was a good outcome, but instead look at what information was available, what the considerations were at the time, to assess whether a wise decision, whether there was a wise decision-making process. And as I said, with the Churchill example, it turns out Halifax made some very powerful arguments. And to Halifax's credit, he ended up pushing Churchill, I think, to much better understand what the good arguments were. And the best argument, in my mind at least, I always, in each of these chapters, I give my opinion, so you can argue with me or disagree. But the argument that I found very persuasive was Churchill said, look, the British people don't know how dire the circumstances are. If we negotiate, if we have Mussolini mediate, the word is going to get out that we're negotiating. And the dilemma we all understand is it's very likely negotiations may fail because Hitler may demand too much. Halifax had acknowledged that if Hitler asked the British to give up their fleet, give up all their colonies, they wouldn't do it. Halifax said, of course, we'll fight. Halifax also said, if you don't sit down and talk, how are you going to know what he's going to demand? But in fact, what Churchill said, and I thought this was a powerful argument, if we negotiate, it won't be kept a secret. There's a very substantial probability negotiations will fail. And if they do fail, the costs in terms of my capacity as a wartime leader to rally our people to make the sacrifices that are going to be necessary have been substantially damaged. Now, one can disagree with that, but I thought that was a very sensible and plausible argument.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Robert Mnookin, Harvard Law School professor and renowned expert on negotiation, who is discussing how to surmount the most challenging interpersonal conflicts. Bob, how can we apply these principles to current domestic policies regarding public health?
Coming from Massachusetts, this is a bit of an embarrassment. I think in terms of negotiation, what you also have to think hard about is what can I do to improve my alternative if negotiation doesn't work? And this is just my own personal view, and I'm not there. We've got Victor Fuchs here. We've got some experts on health economics. But my own view is the reason, with some ambivalence, I endorsed, I would have gone along with either the Senate or the House bill, although they're both very imperfect, and although I think neither would be a long-run equilibrium. But the reason I strongly favor it is that either would have gone much further in underscoring a moral obligation to provide health to, if not all Americans, nearly all Americans, irrespective of their economics. Now, I guess my own personal hope is that the House will have the courage to pass the Senate bill, in which case it doesn't have to go to the conference committee. And I could imagine a deal where part of the deal was there would be subsequent amendments that might be used that could avoid the requirement of 60 votes that could be achieved through reconciliation, where that could be the, quote, payoff to the House. I hope that President Obama, when he has his health summit, the Republicans are, of course, asking, okay, if we're going to go to the summit, the deal has to be as a precondition. People in negotiations are always insisting on preconditions. The precondition is the old bills are dead, they're off the table. I hope to God President Obama doesn't agree to that, because I want him to be able to credibly threaten to pursue the strategy I just described. And I think if it were credible, it might turn out that there would be some Senate Republicans that might be prepared to go along with some kind of other kind of negotiated deal. But I guess the lesson is it's not either or. And in terms of our national politics, I'm horrified by the extent to which tribalism, demonization, dehumanization, moralism, all these traps are so characterizing a lot of the rhetoric that's emanating from Congress, and I think that's quite destructive.
To continue along that same line, what advice would you give to Obama in his efforts to get our representatives in Congress to work together to achieve some progress?
Well, I think the biggest trap we're seeing from Congress is what I call the zero-sum fallacy. I mean, and it's not just Republicans who view it this way. There are many Democrats who feel the same way, that giving anything to the Republicans is a loss for us. And that's nonsense. Now, the good news, although it certainly hasn't worked very well in the last couple years, is you'd think, as a negotiation analyst, legislators are repeat players. They're dealing with each other, not for a one-shot negotiation, but they're dealing with each other repeatedly over time. And normally, I mean, we've got lots of research and theory to demonstrate this, when there's repetitive play, it's much easier to have some degree of cooperation, because you know if you scorch the earth now, you may need their vote sometime in the future, and you're much less likely to get it. Having said that, I think that the media has played a very destructive role, where, I mean, on the media these days, what they often have is they get people who espouse the most extreme kinds of positions on both directions, and then they have a fight on television. It's not very illuminating. Indeed, I have to say, it's a little bit of a plug, the one thing I like about the NewsHour is they will often have experts on who don't entirely agree but are prepared to acknowledge that the other person that's also on the show is making some points that are pretty good. And I wish that were more often the case.
So which wins more often, pragmatism or principle?
Well, I was thrilled by a recent article that was in the International Herald Tribune about my book, where he said the book was a manifesto for pragmatism. I'm a pragmatist, and I like to think that there are certainly principles I care about, but, I mean, basically, the reason the book articulates a presumption in favor of negotiation is, I think, the far more common error is to refuse to negotiate, particularly with an adversary you really don't like, under circumstances where you could make yourself better off if you would negotiate. So I think, in fact, I've got to plead guilty to being a pragmatist who, in fact, in the book, what I hope I demonstrate is real sympathy for the impulse to want to pursue perfect justice and the impulse to want to right wrongs. It's a good thing. On the other hand, I think it's got to be balanced, in my view, against other concerns as well. And to that extent, because I am prepared to balance, I'm a pragmatist.
What do you think about the power of many teachers' unions, which some believe is holding back the potential of many public school districts?
I want to plead the fifth. I like charter schools. I even like the idea of vouchers. So on many policy issues, I find myself not on the same side as the teachers' unions. On the other hand, the teachers' unions certainly have a perfect right to try to defend the economic and other interests of public school teachers. I think the difficulty is that in many municipal areas, in my view, they have too much power. And that, in fact, the way school board elections work, it's hard to have much countervailing pressure.
Have you ever mediated large unions versus large industrial manufacturers in their collective bargaining, i.e. auto workers versus GM or Ford?
Never. In fact, my experience as a mediator has almost exclusively been in complex commercial cases between big companies. Indeed, Peter Pastreich, whom I count as a friend. Peter, are you here now? Peter's here. When I was first went out to talk to the San Francisco Symphony, and there's nothing like being interviewed for a job you're not sure you want. Peter was my inquisitor, and he asked me, what experience have you had in labor management mediation? I said, none. And he said, what do you know about the symphony business? And I said, I attend concerts, but not much else. But the truth is, it was a thrilling experience to work with the musicians and the trustees and the management of the San Francisco Symphony. But I do not consider myself a labor management expert at all. I did put together a team that included a colleague who was then teaching at MIT, who, in fact, has vast experience in it.
How does negotiating with family, business, and global entities differ? What do they have in common?
Well, what they have in common, and it's the reason I chose to write a book that included all three, is I think these negative traps that can characterize international politics can also apply, in my experience, in high-stakes commercial conflicts and in family conflicts as well. And I also think that often, not always, a problem-solving approach to negotiation can be productive in all three domains. The stakes are obviously quite different. Churchill, Mandela were making, as leaders, were making decisions on which lives were at stake. Kastner and Sharansky were opposing evil regimes where their lives were very much at stake. In most commercial and family disputes, there's often a perception of evil, but in my view, it's nearly always just that, a perception that's driven by anger, and that if people understood the perspective of each other more, they'd realize that they may disagree profoundly with the person, and that person may have done some things, some acts, like all of us, of which they're not proud. But I think that in business and family disputes, true evil, which I define as the deliberate infliction of terrible harm on another human being without justification, is unusual.
How did you handle confidentiality issues regarding the disputes you have mediated?
Well, there are only two disputes that I was involved in where I really felt had the freedom to even name names, and that was the IBM case and the Symphony case. And the reason in both instances is because I had the wisdom when I was negotiating my deal to include a provision that I could write about it afterwards, because I thought they would both be situations from which there could be a broader learning. But for the other cases in the book, I've disguised things so that I think one couldn't identify any individual people at all.
What general advice would you offer to someone who was struggling with whether to negotiate or not?
The general advice, I think I'm repeating myself, would be, should you bargain with the devil? Not always, but more often than you feel like it.
Have you ever run into a negotiation where a CEO who was about to retire or be transferred is willing to sell out and leave the issues at hand to his or her successors?
Well, a very common problem in negotiations is what in economics is called the principal-agent problem. And that is, you often, in complex negotiations, have a person negotiating on behalf of the real party in interest. A lawyer may be negotiating on behalf of a client. A manager can be negotiating on behalf of a corporation. A diplomat can be negotiating on behalf of her nation. The thing one always has to realize is that individual doing the negotiation has interests of her own or his own, and they may not perfectly align. And one of the tensions in negotiations that you have to manage is how can you best align the interests of the person on behalf of the negotiations being carried out and the person doing the negotiation.
To continue along the line of agents, what advice would you give to the owner of professional sports franchises negotiating with their franchise player who is asking for way too much money and contract guarantees?
Offer him something you think is more appropriate.
Tell us about a time when your negotiations were not successful and what happened.
Well, I think that there are circumstances that arise where, with the benefit of hindsight, I see a lot of legal conflicts where the result is what I'd call lose-lose, and where, in fact, at the end of the day, there were any number of negotiated deals that might have made both parties better off, but somehow it couldn't be brought about. One of the most gratifying things in terms of being a mediator is you can often help people achieve that result. Moreover, I have to say, I'm very committed to the notion, and I've seen it all the time, and I describe it in the book, where lawyers help their clients resolve conflicts under circumstances where the clients themselves never could do it, because they can be more detached, and they can help the client understand their longer-term interests. So lawyers, in my view, can be very much part of the solution. Regrettably, they are sometimes very much part of the problem.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our guest today is Robert Mnookin, Harvard Law School professor and renowned expert on negotiation, who is discussing how to surmount the most challenging interpersonal conflicts. Despite your praise of Churchill, don't you think Stalin got the best of the deal when it came to dividing Europe after World War II? Please comment on the role of Roosevelt in these negotiations.
Well, I think that I haven't studied Potsdam and the deals that were made at the end of the war, but I think that a brilliant Israeli philosopher named Margalit wrote a book on what he called rotten bargains. And he argued that an agreement between Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin, in which we agreed to repatriate thousands of Eastern Europeans that were behind Western lines in exchange for some of our prisoners, was a rotten bargain, because in fact it was known what would happen to these people if in fact they were sent back. So I'm not expert and I'd want to study it, but with the benefit of hindsight, at least, there were certainly some mistakes made.
Given the perception that we are at war against Islam, how would you approach those that feel we should break the law to handle enemy combatants or terrorists?
First, I think it's nonsense to say that we are at war against Islam. In fact, there are lots of different strands and lots of different kinds of Islam, and it is true that some represent a threat to our values. I think it's wrong to characterize it in those terms. I also think that President Obama has commendably tried to reach out. And even President Bush tried to make that differentiation. I think it's terribly important.
Professor Marvin Minsky demonstrated that most decisions are made with emotion, intuitions at the subconscious level, then justified by us with our rational mind. If so, aren't your cost-benefit analysis piece and your morality piece fundamentally nested subsets, each within the other?
I completely agree. And indeed, one of the issues that I certainly don't resolve, but I address in the book, is that human beings make decisions and think in two radically different ways. One is rational analytic, which is ponderous, it's slow, it's difficult, it's Spock-like. And the other is intuitive. And there is a place for both, but the problem is, what I insist on in the book is that you work through the rational analytic side too, because your intuitive side, that sometimes can be a brilliant insight, it sometimes can be a trap. And the difficulty, of course, and these chapters show this struggle, is human beings often will Sharansky did this. You decide where you want to come out. Sharansky was a chess master. Sharansky describes how he decided completely on the basis of a gut feeling that he felt more free when he resisted. So he decided, I'm going to resist. And what he then did is his gut hired the rational analytic part of his mind to try to work out a strategy. And I think that the human beings do that all the time. But what I want you to do is to sometimes hire the rational analytic part of your mind to be a judge and not just a lawyer to argue for your foregone conclusion. That's not easy, though, and that question is extremely perceptive.
Please discuss techniques you have found that can teach people to be better negotiators. Can they be tested?
I think there's a lot that can be taught in terms of becoming a more effective negotiator. Some of what you can be taught is cognitive, to really understand the various sources of value that can be used to expand the pie. Much of it, though, relates to interpersonal skills. Learning to be a good listener is absolutely indispensable. And I often say that the best negotiators are terrific listeners, A, and B, they also understand themselves, because we all have hot buttons. We can all be thrown off tracks, but I think the most effective negotiators combine interpersonal skills with substantial self-knowledge.
Are the agreements between parties of a mediation signed by the litigants, and do they hold the force of law? Please differentiate between domestic and international.
The answer in terms of any kind of legal dispute is that a mediated resolution can be signed by the parties and will, in fact, then be a binding contract that can be enforced in court. So the answer is yes, it is enforceable. Internationally, of course, there's no international regime necessarily that can enforce certain kinds of agreements, but there often are sanctions that can be imposed. There can be reputational costs. But one difference between the international regime and a domestic regime is that although we're developing more international law, there is no easy way to enforce many sorts of international agreements except diplomatically.
Unfortunately, we've reached the point in our program where we have time for just one final comment. So, Bob, we would like you to leave us with the best advice you have before we adjourn the day.
Avoid the negative traps. And even in these most difficult kinds of conflicts, try to really assess whether negotiation might not make sense.
Our thanks to Robert Mnookin, professor and chair. The negotiation program at Harvard Law School and author of the new book, Bargaining with the Devil, When to Negotiate, When to Fight. We also thank our audiences here and on the radio, television, and the internet. I'm Connie Shapiro, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, where you're in the know, is adjourned. Thank you.